Harper Wave and Harper Audio present 100 Ways to Change Your Life, The Science of Leveling Up Health, Happiness, Relationships, and Success by Liz Moody. This is the author. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider. It contains deep dives, lists, recipes, and more, and will be referred to throughout as the enhancement. This book contains advice and information relating to healthcare. It should be used to supplement rather than replace the advice of your doctor or another trained health professional. If you know or suspect you have a health problem, it is recommended that you seek your physician's advice before embarking on any medical program or treatment. All efforts have been made to assure the accuracy of the information contained in this book as of the date of publication. This publisher and the author disclaim liability for any medical outcomes that may occur as a result of applying the methods suggested in this book. To the Liz Moody Podcast family, my favorite people to learn, laugh, and grow with. Thanks for taking this journey with me. My story. As a child, I was filled with existential angst. I would stay up at night fretting about the short amount of time we have on this planet and my need to make every single moment count. It was, to be honest, pretty annoying. But I also feel lucky that, from my earliest memories, I was never satisfied with the status quo. When I was 2 years old, my mother was in a serious accident, the ripple effects of which impacted my whole family. She almost lost her life, my parents got divorced as a result of it, and all our worlds were forever marked by a sense of before and after. I want to be clear, I'm not glad it happened. I hate when people pitch platitudes and try to make us feel grateful for the utter garbage life throws at us. I do think, though, that there are always opportunities to learn and grow, even in the hardest situations. Do I wish my mom hadn't gotten on that horse that day? Yes, 100%. Am I going to cling to the lessons I've learned and earned the hard way? Absolutely. That experience gave me a hyper-awareness that life is both precious and unguaranteed, and that in a world of finite time, it's up to us to make each moment meaningful. The only problem? I didn't really know what that meaning should be. Unsure of where else to find purpose and passion, the day I graduated from high school, I flew to Europe, where I backpacked for months and ended up working at a coffee shop in Amsterdam. Yes, that kind of coffee shop. I was plagued with self-loathing at the time, and entangled my desire to live large with the need to be cool that led me to take on a party girl persona that fit like a tight, itchy sweater. For the next few years, I sought satisfaction in molly-addled dance parties in Prague, mushroom journeys in France, cocaine-fueled late nights in Buenos Aires. One day, after smoking some marijuana I'd purchased from a questionable source in Brazil, I had a seizure. I was traveling by myself at the time and suffering from an eating disorder that I wasn't yet willing to admit to. I remember sitting in the sand, having not eaten breakfast that morning or dinner the night before, as the haze from the weed descended into an aggressive feeling of panic and hunger. I got up and made my way to a local burger joint. I was at the counter trying to procure the food that the flashing alarms in my body were demanding when everything went black. That was the day I severed trust with my body. In the years that followed, I started having panic attacks. While doctors said my seizure was caused by severe undernourishment combined with sketchy weed, I was sure that it was simply my body betraying me, and if it had done so once, it was likely to do so again. In my late 20s, I was living in London with my then boyfriend and now husband and regular podcast fixture, Zach. Isolated from my community, devoid of the coping structures I'd built into my life, my anxiety spiraled. I started having panic attacks on the tube, the already close walls of the Piccadilly line squeezing in around me as my vision tunneled. I abandoned my cart at a grocery store after the line I was waiting in made me feel trapped, and the white walls and snack-stocked aisles began to tilt on their axes. I started making up excuses not to go out with Zach and our friends. My world became the size of my house, and then my room, and then my bed, where I would lie for the entirety of the day, afraid of the panic attack I'd have if I left it. I still remember the feeling of being horizontal under the comforter with my computer propped on its side and thinking, I guess this is my life now. At least I have the internet. I can stream movies. I can send emails. There I was, the existentially ambitious child, the person who was so intent on seizing every single moment, and I couldn't even get out of bed. I wasn't living my best life. I wasn't living any sort of life. A layer of depression descended on top of my anxiety. Where had I gone so wrong? I did, however, have one critical asset: years of professional experience in finding answers. I'd been working as a journalist for over a decade by then. I had started working for the local paper when I was 16 after I secured an interview with Hootie and the Blowfish, who were playing in my small Central Valley town in California. Shortly thereafter, I pitched a column and began writing about my experience of the world on a weekly basis. My first job out of college was running an editorial team at a startup, which later evolved into writing for publications like Goop, Marie Claire, and Glamour, and, much later, into serving as the food director for leading wellness media company MindBodyGreen. I'd internalized the notion that if I had questions, there were experts out there who'd spent their lives researching the exact explanations I sought. I began emailing people I likely had no right to contact, putting into practice one of my core mantras, never be the one to say no to yourself, which we'll talk about later. I wrote to a Stanford neuroscientist and asked what was going on in my brain during panic attacks, and how, from a neurochemical perspective, an anxious brain differed from a calm brain. From my horizontal position, propped up on pillows with my cat curled up against me, I sent notes that crossed the thousands of miles I no longer could. I emailed registered dietitians, hormone specialists, psychiatrists, and psychologists. I dove into published research and messaged study authors with my questions. Not all of them wrote back, of course, but some of them did. And slowly, I got a sense of why I was feeling the way I was feeling, and advice on some different pathways that might help me feel different. Because I was still daunted by the prospect of doing, well, almost anything, I decided to start with one simple change, something that felt achievable and that didn't require leaving my house. I committed to making a green smoothie every morning. It combined many of the food recommendations I'd gathered from the registered dietitians I'd spoken to, while also incorporating the advice I'd received from a psychologist to add some type of structure or routine to my day. Zach picked up the ingredients for me. I still wasn't ready to go to the grocery store. And the next day, I climbed out of the safety of my bed and padded downstairs. Heart pounding, I loaded the ingredients into the blender and turned it on. And I was healed! Just kidding. My life didn't change so dramatically that day, but it did change. I made another smoothie the next day, and the next, and so on. Before long, it became a habit. Soon, I found myself looking forward to getting out of bed in the morning. I started to drink my smoothie at the kitchen table instead of taking it back to my room. Once I was up and wandering around the house, I'd think, I wonder if there's anything else I could do that might help me even more. I added 5 minutes of meditation and, after that, a daily reading from a book that inspired me. In time, with sweaty palms, I could even take a walk around the block. And now, years later, I'm writing this book on a plane as I travel by myself from one country to another. Since my bout with agoraphobia, I've had high-powered magazine editor jobs in New York City. I've married the man of my dreams. I've ended my apartment lease to nomadically traverse the most beautiful places in the country. I've whitewater rafted and summited 14,000-foot mountains. I've published 2 successful books. And I'm lucky enough to have the job of my dreams, hosting the Liz Moody podcast. In some ways, I've taken that anxious person, trapped in her bed, and turned her into an inspiration for my weekly work. But instead of asking the world's leading minds, how can I live my best life, I get to ask for all of us. I also learned an important lesson on my road to healing, that our best life is the culmination of every part of our mind, body, and external environment. When I didn't have relationships and community connection, my anxiety spiked, leaving me even more isolated. When I was traveling and doing drugs and partying into the night, I hadn't addressed the trauma of my childhood that had led to my constant need for stimuli and validation. When I didn't give my body the nourishment it needed, it rebelled acutely and terrifyingly. It's all connected. To get the most out of every moment, we need to learn the skills to work through our past and create meaningful relationships in the present. We need to pay attention to our finances so that we have the resources to eat nourishing food and have extraordinary experiences. We need to take care of our physical health to minimize pain and discomfort, and to give ourselves the energy we need to accomplish everything we want to each day, the cognitive ability to enjoy as many moments as possible, and the longevity to feel good for years to come. We need to nurture our psychological selves, so not only are we not trapped in a bed, but we also tap into our potential, our contentment, our gratitude, our satisfaction. There are amazing resources out there that provide great advice on how we can transform our physical health or shift our mindsets or change the way we interact with the world at large. But I wanted to create a guide that not only included the most evidence-based versions of these ideas, but also helped us connect the dots between them. Our microbiomes impact our productivity. Our careers impact our hormone levels. Our sex lives impact our sense of self-worth, and that same self-worth impacts our ability to draw boundaries with our parents or ask for the raise we know we deserve. Moreover, the pursuit of a better life shouldn't feel like punishment. It shouldn't feel like a chore or homework or a list of things we're missing out on. It should feel like an opening, an expansion into how it's possible to feel. It should feel easy to understand, like chatting with a really smart friend who knows all the science but is going to explain it to you in a way that won't make you fall asleep. That's where this book comes in. This is your all-in-one resource for living your unique best life. I wanted to answer the question that so many of us often have when ingesting some of the amazing research we have access to these days via books, media articles, and podcasts. That's fascinating, but what should I actually do? It's a question I've become known for asking in a million different ways on the Liz Moody podcast. What are the best foods for our metabolic health? How does our childhood trauma show up in our adult life? And what's one thing we can do today to rewrite damaging patterns? What's the best strategy to ask for a raise? And what specific word should we use? What's the most pragmatic, actionable way to apply this advice in order to feel the benefits today? And now I've taken it even further by collecting the best advice and tools from the podcast and expanding on them to make a book full of actions. These tips distill the wisdom that the world's leading experts have shared across thousands of hours of the Liz Moody podcast episodes, mixed with some of my own mantras that I've found made the largest difference in my years on this planet. You'll gain an understanding of the science, and then you'll learn how to apply it in ways that will change your life. Every single tip has an associated action. Every single lesson comes with a thoughtful way to apply it and thus reap the benefits. And every single moment is packed full of takeaways. My goal is for you to feel like you're getting 50 books in one. Some of these changes are more significant than others. You might find yourself engaging in recurring plans to benefit from the science-backed ways to make more friends, or making over your meals to be more metabolically healthy so they fuel every single cell in your body. Some are tiny. You'll find a breathing exercise that can change your physiology in under a minute. And in a little while, you'll learn about the two-minute trick that fights inflammation, decreases cortisol levels, and increases resilience. Some will solve problems that have stood in your way for years, whether that's chronic pain or an inability to stick to a workout routine. Some will simply change your perspective on things you already do. After listening to chapter 144, for example, you'll never see trudging through the rain with heavy groceries the same way again. Every single tip is designed to create real change, to help you figure out your most authentic, fully realized self, and then become that person. Because of the format, your path will be different from the path of anyone else who uses this book, and that's intentional. Your best life is unique to you. It's not your mom's best life, or your best friend's best life, or that celebrity you follow on Instagram's best life. And what you eat, do, and think every day should reflect that. There are no extreme promises, and there is no bullshit, only well-researched ideas and advice from credentialed experts, distilled into approachable, accessible actions that you can take today. Some habits might result in instant shifts, while others might transform your life over the course of a week or a month. Some days might nudge you in a positive direction, while others might shake your entire worldview. But I promise you this. These little changes add up to a big difference. Day after day, we'll build a rock-solid foundation for a life that will make you feel vibrant, energized, calm, confident, and ready to take on whatever the world throws at you. This is the book I wish I'd had when I was lying alone in that bed in London. This is the book I want to give to my sister, my best friends, my mom and dad, and all of my dear listeners. This is a book of action. This is a guide to your best life. How to use this book. After interviewing hundreds of the world's leading minds, I've learned two underlying realities about living our best life. That we all have individual paths to healing and happiness, and that there are a select few truths about transformation that tend to apply to almost everyone. I designed this book to reflect both of these realities and to cut through the soft promises that litter the personal growth space. No matter what, I recommend everyone start with the first section of the book, How to Define Your Best Life, where you'll learn how to define your goals and measure your results. After working in the wellness industry for over a decade, I've seen far too many people pursue habits, routines, and diets that they abstractly feel are good for them with no sense of why. Your time, money, and energy are precious. If you're adding anything to your life, I sure as heck want you to know why that thing is worth adding. After that, if you'd like to listen to the book in a linear order from beginning to end, like, well, a normal book.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.